Amen. So yeah, I'm so I'm grateful to be here. I always get a little nervous, but just, you know, bear with me. Thank you guys for praying. I'm feeling okay, but just bear with me if my mind's a little scattered this morning, or this afternoon, clearly. Okay, you guys don't have to open with me, but if you want to, if you're kind of those people that like to like follow along word by word, just open with me to Mark 10. I'm just going to be honest. At the start of this little, I don't know if I want to call it a message, but this conversation with you guys, I want to be honest. Everything that I'm about to say, I feel I'm wrestling with, like, in my own heart. And I just want to be honest. In some ways, as I preach it, I indict myself. And in some ways, as I am going to bring this message, I am before your eyes showing myself also as, in some ways, an unfit disciple. But in the grace of God, I want to share it in the faith and in hopes that though we are not perfect representations of Jesus, though we do not follow him perfectly, that he is moved by our yes to him. He is moved by our reach to look like him and to live like him and to walk like he walked. And I'll be honest with you guys this morning. I in some ways wish that there was something else on my heart to share with you. Brian kind of said it before his message, and it's actually a little bit of a similar tenor to what he said is kind of what I'm going to share this afternoon. But I kind of wish that this wasn't what he put on my heart. I kind of just wish I could just tell you Christ did it all, and that's enough, and it is. And I could say that today and leave, and if you guys believed that, I think it would change history. You know, if a group of people really believed that Christ paid it all. He did it all on Calvary. He accomplished his work. And that's that. That we're sons of God. We're daughters of God. There's no earning salvation. There's no earning righteousness. But he did it. His work is completed and finished for us on our behalf. That is true this morning. And if this message was about, I wish in some ways this message was about that. But I feel like the Lord has just impressed something else on my heart to share with you guys. I just want to be real. I feel like I wish I could be sitting right there listening to myself preach. It's as much for me as it is, I believe it is for you guys. But I sense that the Spirit would give to us today an invitation to true discipleship, to radical obedience to Jesus' words and what he spoke when he walked with us on the earth. And so I'm just going to share a few things. I'm going to try to tie it to missions. And in it all, I'm going to share some of my own story. And bear with me, and don't worry if I cry a lot. That's completely normal. So just, yeah, don't worry about that. Okay, so I'm here. I'm in Mark 10. And if you want to look with me, I'm going to be in verses 17 through 27, really. This afternoon, it's my intention to contrast two unnamed men in Scripture. It's kind of weird, I know, and I'll tell you who the second one is later on down the line, but I was kind of struck this morning. I was sitting and I was preparing, and I was kind of struck at this. It's a little bit odd, but there's these two unnamed men in Scripture who in some ways were given the same invitation, and they responded differently, and I want to encourage you and say that I, with you, want to respond the way the second man did. But this morning, I'm going to start with the first. And so it's Mark 10, 17. A lot of us know it. It's the story of the rich young ruler. I'm just going to read these 10 verses to you. It says, as he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up to him, and he knelt before him, and he asked him, good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and mother. And he said to him, teacher, I have kept all these things from my youth up. And I love this next verse. I don't even really know fully what it means or why Mark puts it in here. There's three accounts of this story, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. They all give an account of this story, but here, Jesus says this incredible thing, or he doesn't say it, it says this of Jesus. Looking at him, Jesus felt a love for him, and he said to him, one thing you lack, go and sell all you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come follow me. But I want you to catch these next words. We're in verse 22. But at these words, the rich young ruler, but at these words, he was saddened, and he went away grieving, for he was one who owned much property. And Jesus, looking around, said to his disciples, how hard it will be for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus answered again, and he said to them, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. And they were astonished, and they said to him, then who can be saved? And looking at them, Jesus said, with God, with people it is impossible, but with God all things are possible. I'm just going to go back up to verse 20. Jesus tells him these few things. He says, do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal. He kind of lists this list. And he says something pretty amazing. He says, teacher, I have done all of these things that you have commanded. I have kept these from my youth. He's saying, since I was a young man, I have not disobeyed the words that you spoke. That alone is pretty amazing to me. But then Jesus says something, and I feel like it would just be so much easier if it wasn't there, but it is there, and so I'm going to read it again. He says, okay, he feels a love for this man. He looks at this young man, or this maybe middle-aged, I don't know, man, who since his youth has followed the words of Jesus, and it says Jesus feels a love for him. I think, I'm not like a scholar. I'm not saying this is the same in the Greek, but I have this sense as I read it that it's a similar to like a compassion. Jesus feels a compassion on this young man. Wow, he's kept my word. But right now he's wrestling with the truth of being a disciple. And then Jesus says this, and this, if we don't allow this word to divide us, spirit, soul, and body, if this word that Jesus speaks doesn't divide us, well, Jesus makes it plain, we can't be his disciples. He says, one thing you lack, go and sell all you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and you come and follow me. And it says the man, he hears Jesus's words. Excuse me, I'm sniffly. He hears Jesus' words, and it says that he's grieved within him because he was a man who had much, or he owned much property. The different accounts say it differently. So I read this, and I think, okay, I don't know if I can say I've kept all of Jesus' commands from my youth, but I like try, and I'm like kind of with there, like there with him. I want to keep Jesus' commands. And I don't have a lot of property. I don't have like a lot of wealth. So that's good. I'm kind of in the clear there. But then I hear Jesus's words. And to me, they go deeper than what he says to this young man. They go deeper than just for, this word alone is not reserved for the wealthy, is what I'm trying to say. I feel that this morning Jesus would ask this of all of us, or say this to all of us. Okay, I have seen that you have kept my ways from your youth. But now this is what I ask of you. Go sell all of your possessions, give to the poor, and then come and follow me and be my disciple. And we know the account. We know the story. I just read it. This man is grieved in his spirit. He considers that Jesus has asked too much of him. And he turns around and he walks away, and we never hear of him again. I know this is like, you're like, what are you talking about? I'm in college. I don't have a lot of possessions. Well, turn with me to Luke 9. I don't think it's just about possessions. Luke 9, 57. In verse 57, it says, as they were going along the road, someone said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. He says this to Jesus. How many of us have said that? I will follow you wherever you go. Have you said that to Jesus? Oh, y'all know I for sure have said that to Jesus. I will follow you wherever you go. And then this is Jesus' response. And Jesus says to him, the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And you never hear of that man again in Scripture. Once again, a man hears the demands of Jesus and he says, nope, that's too much. He is asking too much of me. I cannot follow him. And then again in verse 59, and he said to another, follow me. But he said, Lord, permit me first to go and bury my father. In at first glance, we see this is a reasonable request. Come on, Lord, come on. It's reasonable that he goes and he wants to bury his dad. He wants to say, you know, he wants to grieve with his family. But this is Jesus' response. He said to him, allow the dead to bury their own dead. But as for you, go and proclaim everywhere the kingdom of God. And we're left to realize once again that this man counted these words of Jesus as too costly because once again, we never hear of him in Scripture. I think again, like the rich young ruler, he looks at Jesus, he hears these words, and he says, no, that's too much to ask. And he walks away. And then once again, He says, another also said, I will follow you, Lord, but permit me first to say goodbye to those at home. But Jesus said to him, no one, after putting his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. And once again, we see that this man, he's not there. He's counted, I'm going to read this little book called True Discipleship. I'm going to be reading excerpts about it today. I've just found it. My mom bought it for me a few weeks ago. My dad and I were talking about it. It's kind of where this message has come from. But this is what he says about the third man, who the writer, the author of this book, calls Mr. Too Easy. He says, we are first forced to conclude that Mr. Too Easy left Jesus and walked sadly down the road. His overconfident aspirations to be a disciple had dashed themselves to pieces on the rocks of congenial family bonds. Perhaps it was a weeping mother who sobbed, you'll break your mother's heart if you leave me to go to the mission field. We do not know. All we know is that the Bible graciously refrains from giving the name of this faint-hearted fellow who, by turning back, missed the greatest opportunity of his life and earned the epitaph, not fit for the kingdom of God. We look at these three men, we look at the rich young ruler, and this is what we see. Four men are given an opportunity to come and to follow Jesus, which we in this room, I know with sincerity, want to do. But four men are given the means by which they must follow their master, and every one of them counts that his cost, the demands of what a disciple should look like in Jesus's eyes, every one of them considers it too much. And then the writer says, did you hear that last paragraph? They miss the greatest opportunity of their lives, following the real incarnate God of the universe, who's walking and breathing and spitting in people's eyes and healing them, the real Son of God, the real King of the universe. They miss following him, and they earn, if you don't know what an epitaph is, that's kind of like an old school weird word. What it means is on his gravestone, it's written, he was not fit for the kingdom of heaven. I don't know about you guys. I'm not up here in pride. I'm gonna be so real with you guys. I wish there was another way. I wish that Jesus wouldn't have said so clearly these things, because these things demand everything. I think of I have a little boy, my husband and my son. I don't know where they are. I didn't even introduce them, but Kenny, my amazing husband. My last name is Swetman, not Engel, Troy. But they're kind of in the back. He's probably trying to get Jubal to sleep or something. I have a 4-month-old little boy. He's perfect. And I think of what it will take for me to be a true disciple, what it will demand of his life. It's going to demand of his life, in my case, probably that he's going to grow up in a Middle Eastern country. He's going to learn to walk on the dusty streets of Erbil, Kurdistan. He's going to learn a different language. He's going to be far from his cousins. And he's going to watch his parents labor so that Jesus can return, so that he can have his reward in this nation, in the nations of the earth. You don't have to clap. I'm not a hero. I'm being real with you guys. That is hard. It is hard for me to count the cost of what true discipleship looks like. But when you look at it in the scripture, there's really no other way. It says, Jesus says, unless you take up your cross and you sell all that you have, you cannot be my disciple. Now look, I want to be honest and I want to be very clear. I am not preaching something like hatred of the American dream thing. I feel like we do that. It's not always the best. No, we love to crucify that. We cannot judge what obedience is in another man's life. I want to be honest with you. There are men and women who live in nice houses, who have nice jobs, who right now are literally funding the reaching of every home for the gospel. There are men and women who are raising their children in America, and in their case, it's not wrong. It is obedience, and what they're doing is they're funding 24-year-old missionaries so that they can go and they can preach Jesus where he is not named. We are not heroes. I am not preaching some weird, you can't love Jesus in America. If that's true, we're all in trouble. But what I am trying to communicate this morning is that Jesus does make it clear, even for the one called to stay and labor in America, he makes it clear what it should look like. And it looks like this: all that you hold dear, you count as nothing for the sake of my name. It looks like this: if you love me, then you'll obey my commands. You ever just meditated on that? You think about what that demands of us? Thinking, Jesus, I love you. He's saying, I know, Gloria, I know that you love me. Jesus, I love you. I know that you love me. But Gloria, if you love me, you'll obey my commands. And what does Jesus command? This is what he commands. You sell all that you have, all of your possessions, you give to the poor, and you follow him. This is true discipleship. And left, right, up and down, I can't really find another way out of it, though I wish I could. Excuse me, I'm sniffling so much. These two last, in Luke 9, the two last guys, it's kind of just interesting. I won't stay on it long, but their words to Jesus, their response to Jesus are both, Lord, me first. Lord, let me first go and bury my father. Lord, me first. Let me first go and say goodbye to my family. There is not a diluted form of discipleship that Jesus has given to those who kind of want to follow him most of the time. He is not looking for your weekends. He's not looking for your evenings or your retirement years. He is looking for your everything. Thank you so much, Neil. He is not looking for just a part of you. He's looking for all of you. He demands everything. It's just so simple. I wish it were different, but it's not. He demands everything. And there's not a diluted form of discipleship that we can hold on to and grasp. Yeah, that was fine in present day Israel, but for me in Georgia, for me in Iowa, for me in my college campus in America, in Central California, it can look different because he just didn't know. He wasn't here. He wasn't walking with us. This cannot be so. This cannot be so. Jesus lays out what the life of a disciple should look like, and he doesn't say this only applies to this century Jews. He says, if you want to be my disciple, then take up your cross and follow me. There is not a diluted way. Christ says, he says, come, and he says, follow me. And if you don't give up all you have, you cannot be my disciple. I know I keep saying that, but it's because essentially that's what's on my heart this morning. Okay, Lord, I want to be your disciple. I want to be your disciple. I know that. That much is clear. I look around this room as worship is going on. I see you guys worshiping. You're on your faces. You're raising your hands. I have no doubt in my heart that you guys are so genuine, that you're so real. You're looking at me. You're like, Gloria, I want to be a disciple, but I'm just trying to like stay a Christian on my college campus. I get that. I get that right now you guys are in a different sort of trench. I understand, and I know that your faith is sincere, but the truth is we're all waiting for the outpouring of God on our college campus, but none of us are willing to take up our cross and die. None of us are willing to follow Jesus, and I think unless we do, I might be wrong here, but unless we can do that, the outpouring's not going to come. We all want revival, but none of us want to be the sacrifice upon which revival falls. It's not going to just come in the nations. It's going to take a yes. It's going to take a, okay, Lord, I'll sell all. I will sell all and I will follow you, and I'm not going to listen to the other voices. There will always be voices that seek to cut inches off the cross. There will always be voices that are seeking to say no, but it doesn't quite have to look like it looked for your master. But I would say this to you this morning. The servant is not greater than his master. The student is not greater than his teacher. And unless we begin to look at the cross and in truth say, Lord, we can't do it on our own. We cannot embrace that life on our own, but by your spirit we can. Unless we begin to do that, I fear for our generation. I fear that it will simmer out, and in 10 years, none of you are going to know any of each other's names, and you're going to look back to Mount Hermon United Conference, and you're going to remember it as a fond memory, as the love of your youth. But the fact is, we cannot heed the voices. We cannot heed the voices that say, no, there's another way. There's another way, because there's not. It's laid out so clearly, and I'm with you guys this morning in this struggle. God, are you sure? Are you sure that's the way it has to be? And he says, yeah, I'm sure, but it's okay because I showed you how to live that way. I took up my cross. I was obedient unto death. And now you know how. Just fix your eyes on me. Look at me and I will show you. I will show you the crucified way. I will show you the Calvary road. But unless we do that, well, I don't know. I want to be clear. It's not an issue of salvation. You guys are saved by grace and by faith in Jesus Christ. Today, if you believe in him, if you believe he's the only way to the Father, you're saved. It's not an issue of salvation. But many will get to heaven and they'll look around and they will wish they had given him more than they did. And we don't want to be those people. We don't want to look upon that face that still has scars from that crown of thorns. We don't want to look into his burning eyes and say, oh, I wish I would have given you more. We have one chance, one mere 80 years, maybe, if you're healthy, to give to Jesus. We don't want to wish that we had given him more when we had the breath in our lungs to give him more. It's not salvation. It's about a way that we get to choose to live like disciples. And to me, and as far as I can see in Scripture, correct me if I'm wrong, but as far as I can see, it's the only way. Those four men, they were considered unfit for the kingdom of heaven. I want to share a little statistic. I know Stephen gave you guys like a ton of statistics this morning. It's really powerful. I wish I could have been here. But I want to share one statistic, and I want to do it not in a light to bring any sort of shame or pointing the finger. In fact, I won't even tell you the country. Right now, there is a big country that's not our own, and they are right now sending missionaries in a huge rate. I mean, it's pretty incredible to see how many missionaries they're sending to the field. They're sending young, fiery people to the nations of the earth. And the statistic is that these missionaries are lasting 2 to 6 months on the field before coming home. They're lasting 2 to 6 months, and then they're coming home, and there's no other way to look at it but by this. They're lasting for that much time because the love of culture and the love of family, the love of comfort and familiarity is so strong that it is pulling them from their place of standing with Jesus in the nations. It's pulling them home. I don't say that to bring shame. I'm going to be really honest with you guys. Living on the field is not easy. I did it just for 2 years. 2 years is hard, and I didn't last much longer than that. The Lord called me home, and I'll be honest about that. But the reality is that, yes, it's not easy. It is not easy to follow the Lamb wherever he goes. We want to say, we'll follow you. It's challenging. There are real challenges. But right now, if the sending movements that we're praying for look like missionaries staying 2 to 6 months, it's not enough time. That's not enough time to see a nation saved. I mean, in a lot of our context, that's not enough time to see one person saved and discipled enough to actually make it out until the day Jesus splits the sky. What I'm saying is this: the love of our culture, the love of comfort, the love of our family and our food and our music and the ways that we tell jokes and the way that we can speak our own language, those are real things. Those are real things that unless we can say, Jesus, I make up my mind to follow you, come hell or high water. I make up my mind to take up my cross like you. Unless we say that to the Lord before we go, we won't make it. I'm not asking you guys to sign up right now to a life of being a missionary. I'm asking you to sign up to a life of true discipleship. True discipleship is the only way we're going to make any difference in the nations. They are not waiting for young Americans who just want to come and be loud in their cafes, who want to watch Netflix because they're culture shocking, all of which I have done. I'll be real. I have done all of that. But they're not looking for that. The gods of Hinduism are stronger than that. The gods of Islam, the one god, false god of Islam, is stronger than that. What they are waiting for in Yemen is young men and women who are ready to take up their cross. And I'm not saying they're ready to die. Dying is the easy part. They're waiting for young men and young women who have counted everything as loss, who every day will wake up and say again, Lord, I take up my cross as a disciple and I will follow you. We all want to say yes to that big yes, that big dying yes. I don't want to be martyred, but we all want to say yes to that. We've like so glorified that martyr call, that Jim Elliot spear. I don't want to diminish that. Precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his saints. It moves God when men and women die for him in the nations. But that yes is easier than the million yeses that are going to get you there. The yeses start in your college campus room, whatever, dorm room. I didn't go to college, so I don't know what they're called, but their dorm room. They start in choices that you're going to make when no one is watching. They start when you get on your knees and you say, Lord, I don't know what it looks like, and I know in and of myself I cannot follow you as you deserve to be followed. But if you help me, I will, and he will help you. And that's a dangerous prayer, and don't pray it if you don't actually want to follow him. gonna be honest, guys, these people that live like this, these are the only terms. This is the only way that the evangelization of the world is gonna happen. Much less in one generation. The only way that happens, the only way Isaiah 42 is fulfilled and Saudi Arabia is singing, "Come, Lord Jesus, come," the only way that's fulfilled is by men and women who will take up their cross, not tomorrow, but today. And I'm so honest with you guys. I don't know how to do this. But all I know is, okay, I can wake up this morning and say, "Lord, whatever it looks like, I have possessions, some, not tons, but I have some. Lord, I will give those if that's what you're asking me today." And if he says, and that's just got to be simple. That's got to be the easiest yes. Possessions, you guys, possessions are the easiest yes to give up. If that's like where we get stumped, we're really in trouble. If it's just our stuff that's holding us, keeping us from clinging to the cross, we are so in need of him to break in. Now, the possessions, that's the easier one. They get harder along the way. I want to obey the Lord's injunction against laying up treasures in heaven. He says, don't do that. No, against laying treasures on earth. Sorry, I'm sick. I got a little scoot out of that one. No, we want to lay up treasures in heaven. I want to obey his injunction against laying up treasures on earth. Don't you know those things can be destroyed? A thief can break into your home and steal those things. Moth and rust, those things will destroy earthly possessions. But if we obey his words and we begin to make choices to lay up treasures in heaven, then on the day we stand before him, we will not be ashamed. We're not going to be ashamed if we take up our cross now. It's suffering now and eternal glory later. It's a moment of suffering now for an eternity of being with Jesus. Being with Jesus and being radiant because we've looked upon him. Being with Jesus with all those that we've also preached him to and who have given their lives to Jesus. It's so much worth making your aim to bring souls with you to heaven than stuff. Stuff's not coming through those pearly gates. Souls will come. Those who you give your life to preach Christ and him crucified to, those will make it if they say yes to Jesus. But you can't bring your stuff with you. You can't bring all of your earthly stuff. Stuff is killing us. It's killing us. It's killing me. There is one way. The road of discipleship, it's so clear. It looks like this. Looks like Jesus hanging on a tree. And not all that much stuff can fit through that. You know? I can't fit my guitar through this. I can't fit my whatever else you love. I don't know what you love. I don't even love my guitar all that much. But whatever it is you love, you can't even fit your family through that. I can't even fit my son through that. The way of discipleship, the formation of the cross is so demanding. But on the other side, there is joy. On the other side, there is life. You want to make the wise decision now. We want to give up the things that we cannot keep with us so that we can gain the things that we can. I'm crying so much because I feel God doing this in me right now. I'm not preaching this like I've already lived it. I'm preaching it like I want to live it. I gotta be honest. I want to go to the field because of a number of things. Because I want to see Jesus come back. I want to see every tribe and tongue reached. I want to go to the field because there's souls that need to hear. But I'll be so honest. The main reason I want to go to the field is because I want my son to grow up in another form of Christianity than what he sees here. I'm desperate for my own children to believe in the way that Jesus called his disciples to live, and I honestly don't know how to give that to him unless we go. I'm desperate for my 4-month-old to understand, because he's seen it, that the cost is great for following Jesus. Because in Iraq, if you say yes to Jesus, your family wants to kill you. I'm desperate for my son to believe that Jesus is that worthy, and I don't know how to show him that here. I don't. I'm not pointing the finger. I said it earlier. God will call some of you here to nice jobs and big houses, and he's going to call you to fund the movement, okay? I'm not prideful. This is not the only way. But if I'm being honest, to me, it's the simplest way. You can correct me if I'm wrong. Correct me if I'm wrong. You guys are like, she's crazy. She's crying so much. They were crying because my mom's got my little guy in the back, and my husband's sitting there, and we've talked about it. I know what it means. I know what it means to raise my daughters in a country where my face is going to have to be covered. The cost is kind of great, but it's not as great as it would be if... I don't know. Forget it. I already said it. It's far be it from us, the people of Jesus, to seek any road but the road which our Savior walked. Far be it from me to sing about how Jesus is my King and my Lord and then not be willing to pay the smallest price or the biggest price. If I sing he's my King, I gotta obey him like he's my King. I don't see another way around it. If he's my Master, my life has to look like his. It doesn't matter how hard it looks, it has to look like his. It's just so simple in my mind, and just be with me in feeling this. I know it's simple to say, and it's quite contrary to live. It is quite difficult to live what I'm saying right now. Trust me, I feel that. I'm with you. Excuse me. I gotta blow my nose. Guys, I think if the Lord is speaking to you at all right now, my encouragement to you, it would just be heed the voice of the Spirit. Just heed it right now. I'm not saying my message is all that profound, but there are a few moments in your lives, especially as young people, and I can say this because I'm young. There are a few moments in our lives where the Holy Spirit will begin to speak, and in those moments, if we don't reach out to grasp what the Spirit is saying, sometimes those moments pass us by. Brian said it the first night. It's harder to do later down the road. Do it now. Just do it now. I plead with you for your own sakes, for the sakes of your children. Just harping, I know, but. I said it earlier. But this can't be driven by legalism. No man can dictate to another man what the cost is. No one can dictate what picking up your cross looks like to another person. I want to tell you that right now. You don't go home to all of your other like college campus buddies that are like trying to pray with you and be like, hey, you're not a Christian because you're not picking up your cross. No, we cannot dictate to one another what it looks like, but the scripture itself, Christ's words himself, and then that Holy Spirit of God that is in us to convict the human heart, these alone can say to us, make clear to us what the apostolic way or the way of the cross looks like. We must heed that voice that says to us, this is extra. This is not the way of true discipleship. This is not what it looks like to follow the Lamb wherever he goes. We can't say that to one another. I can't say that to you this afternoon, but I can say to my own heart, okay, pay attention to what the Spirit is saying to you. Pay attention to what is necessary and what is excess. We are filled with excess things, excess words, excess everything is excess. Buildings, everything, our homes, our houses filled with stuff. It's all excess and it all fights. It all wars against the apostolic way, but we can make choices that are not empowered by legalism. Legalism is horrible. We have choices empowered by love. Jesus says to us, if you love me, you'll obey me. It's so simple. It's so simple. It's so painful. If you love me, you'll obey me. And we say, Lord, but how are we supposed to live? It's so hard. It's so hard. And he says, just look. Heed the words of the rich young ruler. It is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven, but you sell all that you have We have to heed that voice. It's not easy, but it is worth it in the end. It's motivated by love. We're in it for one man. We are in it for Jesus. If there becomes any other reason that you sell all, it's idolatry. We do it for Jesus and Jesus alone. But if we do it for him, there's an extraordinary promise that's shown to us in a parable of Jesus's. And this is the man, the second man that I'm contrasting the rich young ruler to. And I'm going to bring that up in a second, but I'm not yet. Because my notes. Never thought you'd hear me say that. I want to read you guys something. Oh, this might be kind of a weird page to read it. I mean, a weird place to read it, but I'm going to read it to you anyway. I'm going to read it because a lot of years ago, I was in a class. I was 14, and I was attending. I was auditing. I don't even know if I was officially auditing it or I just showed up every day, but I was auditing a class that Brian was speaking. Don't even remember what the class was. I just remember it changed my whole life. Still changing my life because I'm still trying to heed what he taught in it. That's the first place that I heard this read, and I'm going to read it to you guys. I'm not going to say much about it. I'm just going to let it sit on you for a second. I honestly can't barely come to terms with this. I have yet to see someone my age live like this, including myself, especially myself. This is a letter that was written by a communist man to his fiance, explaining why he's breaking off their engagement. This man is not saved. Just in case you needed to hear that, on top of that, he's communist. He is not saved. He is living, he describes what he's living for in this, but I'm going to just read it, and I'm just going to let it challenge you. It challenges me. I think in some ways he's touched more what true discipleship looks like than many of us who read scriptures every day. He says this: we communists have a high casualty rate. We are the ones who get shot and hung and lynched and tarred and feathered and jailed and slandered and ridiculed and fired from our jobs and in every other way made as uncomfortable as possible. A certain percentage of us gets killed or imprisoned. We live in virtual poverty. We turn back to the party, the Communist Party, every penny we make above what is absolutely necessary to keep us alive. We communists don't have the time or the money for many movies, concerts, T-bone steaks, or decent homes and new cars. We've been described as fanatics. We are fanatics. Our lives are dominated by one great overshadowing factor, the struggle for world communism. We communists have a philosophy of life which no amount of money could buy. We have a cause to fight for, a definite purpose in life. We subordinate our petty personal lives into a great movement of humanity. And if our personal lives seem hard or our egos appear to suffer through subordination to the party, then we are adequately compensated by the thought that each of us in his small way is contributing something to a new and true and better mankind. This is one thing in which I am in dead earnest. This is one thing in which I am in dead earnest, and that is the communist cause. It is my life, my business, my religion, my hobby, my sweetheart, my wife, and my mistress, my bread and meat. I work at it in the daytime, and I dream of it at night. Its hold on me grows, not lessens, as time goes by. Therefore, I cannot carry on a friendship, a love affair, or even a conversation without relating it to this fourth force with which both drives and guides my life. I evaluate people, books, ideas, and actions according to how they affect the communist cause and by their attitude to it. I've already been in jail because of my ideas, and if necessary, I'm ready to go before a firing squad. Tell me this, if our church, if a group of young people can live like this, but for Jesus, we really could change the world. Give me just one man or one woman that would take the words of Jesus, those hard, cutting words of Jesus that say, it is hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom. Go sell all you have and come follow me. If just one lived like that, it would change all of our college campuses. Calls his life, his petty personal life. We subordinate it. You know what he's saying? He's saying we take what we think is ours, our lives and our egos, and we form them to look like the communist cause. This is what Jesus demands of us. He demands that we take our petty personal lives, even though to him they're so precious. We were made in his image. He loves us. He loves your lives. So they're not petty. They're great. But he demands that we take those lives and we fit them into the form of the cross. And anything that cannot step through Calvary's way is cut off of us. And we cannot mourn what is gone from us. For this is the way that Jesus lived. This is the way that he designed it to be. The principle of the gospel is this. The gospel always brings life to the receiver and death to the giver. Those who will hear the message, they will receive life because of it if they believe. But it requires of the giver a dying process that if we are not willing to forgo, we cannot be his disciples. Jesus made it this way. I wish it was another way. But even for Jesus, what brought life to us, what brought to us eternal salvation, it brought to him death. The cross killed our Lord. And we cannot refuse the cross if we want to be his disciples. We cannot refuse him hanging on Calvary. It's too compelling. It's too compelling. Why should we wish to float on by on flowery beds of ease when our master calls to us by and by, come, follow me. He's calling to us, come, follow me day by day. By and by, he says, come and look like me. Come and fix your eyes on Calvary. Why should we seek any road but the road which Jesus walked? If you are going to enjoy the salvation that was purchased on the cross, you must consider Golgotha. You must consider Gethsemane. Before the cross, before he rose again, there was a dying, and even for Jesus, this was hard. He wept. You know, he said to his Father, if there's any other way. He's not looking at you this morning and saying, why is it so hard for you to follow me? He's not saying that to me this morning. He's not saying, Gloria, why is it so hard for you to be my disciple? He remembers Gethsemane. He remembers, God, if there's any other way. But do you know what else he remembers? But not my will. If this is the way, if this is the cup, then I will drink it. Not my will, but yours be done. He's not angry this morning. He's happy, believe it or not. He's happy, but he also demands much. And if we do not give him much, we cannot be his disciples. The cost is everything. It means all a man has, all that a man is. If it meant this for the Savior, it cannot mean less for those who follow him. Excuse me, my nose is running. He who was rich beyond all description voluntarily became poor, then he must demand from us nothing less. If he voluntarily became poor, then we must give to him what he demands if we're going to follow him, and that's to give everything. And surely if Christ is worth anything, then he is worth everything. Oh yeah, thanks. I brought like 3 up and I needed like 20. Excuse me again, you guys. Sorry. Any of you guys ever seen a preacher do that? It's kind of gross, sorry. Love. If you love me, obey my commands. I already said that. I'm kind of all over the place. Holy Spirit, just come. I have like all these things I could read. All these like, guys, this book is like just tearing me up. It's called True Discipleship. It's by William McDonald. I don't know who William McDonald is, but it's literally changing my life. Basically, he just says everything Jesus says, and it's powerful. If you guys want to just open with me, I told you at the beginning of this that I wanted to preach, and in doing so, I wanted to contrast two men. Now, one of them was a real man, and one of them is found in a parable Jesus says, but I'm going to use it anyway. If you will turn with me to Matthew 13, the first man, as you guys I'm sure remember, it wasn't that long ago that I said it, was the rich young ruler. And this second man, I have to find. It's in Matthew 13. Some of you already know. I just got a new Bible, and new Bibles are hard. I'm like, where is everything? Okay, Matthew 13, verse 44. Are you guys there? I want you to get to this one. Write it down. I pray some of you have this as your epitaph. Instead of unfit for the kingdom, I pray this is written there. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field, which a man found and hid again. And from joy over it, he goes and he sells all that he has and he buys that field. Just look with me. We've almost heard this one so much, it's petty. It's so sad because what's written here is so profound, but it's almost become so like cheesy. Like, yeah, we get it. The guy found a treasure. He sold everything. That's weird. And he bought an empty field because there was a treasure in it. But that's exactly what happened. I want to contrast this morning a man named the rich young ruler who was unfit for the kingdom of heaven. He was grieved by it, but still he turned and he walked away. Jesus loved him. It wasn't an issue of the love of Jesus. It says Jesus loved the rich young ruler. He felt compassion on him. He felt love for him. But that wasn't what was on the chopping block. What was on the chopping block was all of his possessions, all of his wealth, and his entire surrendered to Jesus, and he turned and he walked away. And in contrast, Jesus tells of this man who was walking. I don't even know why he was walking in the middle of a big field, but he was, and I don't know why he started digging, but he did, and he found a treasure. He found a treasure that was hidden in a field, and he buries it again. He wasn't looking for the easy way, you guys. He didn't just steal the treasure out of someone else's field. He didn't just put the treasure into his backpack and like leave and still keep all that he had. He wasn't looking for the easy way out. It says he finds the treasure in the field. He doesn't steal it. He buries it again and he goes and he knows this is required to get the treasure. He knows that the treasure is worth these actions. He goes and he sells all. You know his family was like, what are you doing? Why would you sell all that you have? Maybe he had a wife. We don't know. Maybe she was like, honey, what are you thinking? We have kids. We have mouths to feed. Who knows if all his business partners were like, why would you do that? Why would you sell all? But all those voices that were seeking to cut inches off the cross, he said, no. He sold all, and he went and he bought the field, and it didn't say, he was like, now look at me. Like I did this big sacrificial thing. No, all it says is that he was joyful. He had nowhere to sleep that night but an empty field, and he was joyful. He was joyful because it gives us joy when we follow in the pathway of our Savior. It gives us joy when we sell all to buy the field. It gives us joy when the tests come, we see and we step through them and we see, wow, I didn't count my life as more precious than following Jesus. It's joyful. It's joyful to give all. It's joyful and it's painful too. He probably had pain. I don't know. Maybe he didn't. I feel pain. I feel pain when I think of it, but I just don't see another way. I just can't look at the testimony of Jesus. I might be going so long, I haven't looked at that clock at all, sorry. I feel pain when I look at the words of Jesus. Well, if only this half wasn't there. Yeah, blessed are the poor in spirit, that one's good. They get something. Oh, blessed are the meek, they get something too. Oh, even hungry, even if I'm hungry and I hunger, oh, then I'm going to be filled. this is great. I can do this, even though that's hard too. But we can't just take half of the words of Jesus and make that our God. That is not befitting. It is not befitting for a servant to be more gloriously dressed than his master. It is not befitting for a servant to be more fed than his master. It is not befitting for a servant to have a home when his master did not have one. We must make it our aim to be disciples. I know I keep saying that. It's so simple. You're like, God, you've said that word 100 times. I just can't get away from it. I'm going to be honest. Moving to the field next year, I think I surely can't make a disciple if I'm not one. What am I going to say? What am I going to say to these Iraqi women who are going to be beat by their husbands? These young men who are going to be locked in their rooms, true story, by their families. What am I going to say? Hey, you have to be a disciple like Jesus, but the good thing is I was born in America, so I don't. No! Don't go if you're going to preach that. That is harmful. That is not helpful. If you want to go and your hearts are willing, and this isn't even about missions, but it kind of is. But if you want to go and your hearts are willing, this happens first. This happened, and this has to happen first in me. I'm not saying this like I've got it. I'm saying this like, God, help me. Help me make disciples. Help me make imitators of Jesus. People who want to follow him because he's worthy, who have seen him and counted that he is all satisfying, that he is precious, that he alone is the great reward that we're going to receive. When we see that, guys, when we see that Jesus is all satisfying, perfect, precious, when we see him as our treasure, like this man in this story in Matthew 13, when he is the treasure, the selling all is the side point. What's that word, peripheral? You don't see it anymore. It's like a separate thing. When you can see Jesus, when you can see our Savior, the road of Calvary, when you can see him and you realize he did it all and he is what we gain, then the giving of all else, it doesn't necessarily become easy. I'm not going to say that. It doesn't become easy, but it becomes worth it when you see him, when we can look at him and fix our eyes on him. It's the contrast of these two men, both who wanted to follow Jesus sincerely, both who wanted to be followers of Jesus, but one who counted the cost of discipleship as too much to pay. I'm going to wrap it up. CT study said he realized he'd always believed Jesus had died for him, but when he realized that the exchange that took place, that because Jesus had died for him and bought him, that he belonged to Jesus, CT study said he finally realized that his life was not his own, lest he be a thief. Your lives are not your own, and that is good news. It is good to belong to another. And it is good when your master is Jesus. It is good to be free of a love of money and a love of fame and a love of ambition. It is good to be free of the voices that want to dumb down what Christianity is supposed to look like. It is good to be free of those things. And it is good to be chained to Christ. It is good to be a bond slave. That is your freedom. Somewhere in that book, and I didn't write it down and I should have, there's this little poem and I'm gonna mess it up, but it's so powerful. It's basically, I think an unknown author says, like, basically, Lord, I come to your door, pierce my ear. If you guys don't get that, it's a reference in the Old Testament. But he's saying, make me a slave. I don't want another master. That's what he's saying. I really botched that. It's really powerful and beautifully worded. But what he's saying is, God, make me a slave. I don't want freedom if freedom is not being tied to Christ. I don't want freedom if freedom is not the way of the master. And I just feel Jesus, if the worship team wants to come up, if we want to do ministry time, if you guys would just come up whenever, but I feel this morning, I'm just so honest with you guys. I feel this morning he's calling to me. We cannot just love him in word. We cannot. We must love him indeed. Really even know what the altar call is this morning. I feel the Savior calling. Come.